Good morning, everyone. Again, we apologize for the delay, so let's go ahead and get started. Today we're going to discuss bloodborne pathogens and OSHA training. So we will start with a slide demonstration, and we will look at a DVD, and then we will follow up with our questions. I believe everyone is on mute right now, but if you have questions, they can be typed in and I can respond. So if you have any questions, please feel free to type them in so that we can respond. So first we're going to go to our presentation. All persons who are at risk for bloodborne pathogen exposures are required to receive an annual training. So that is what today's training is about, the bloodborne pathogens infection control. Very good. Okay, so let's go over our objectives for the program. So after participating in this program, you will be able to explain the terms related to bloodborne pathogens and infection control. You should be able to discuss the transmission of bloodborne pathogens, HIV, hepatitis A, B, and C. Explain terms of universal precaution and correctly answer the pre-test questions. Next slide. Okay, so first we'll start off with looking at our pre-test questions. So you can think about these as we go through the presentation. The answers will be found throughout the presentation. If blood is not clearly observed in a spill, there is no reason to wear gloves. Is that true or false? If the cut on your hand is covered with a bandage, it is not necessary for you to protect yourself by wearing gloves. True or false? If you don't have a trash bag available, it is okay to throw contaminated material into the classroom with paper basket. If you are wearing a ring that doesn't have sharp edges, it's okay to wear it under your gloves. Number five, it is okay to touch the fixtures on the bathroom once the bloodborne pathogen spill has been sprayed with the disinfectant. Number six, you must always use the antimicrobial soap when hand washing after cleaning up a spill. Number seven, if a student is bleeding, first make sure that he's receiving medical attention, then put on gloves to clean the spill. True or false? And lastly, number eight, custodians should only be called to clean up a spill if it is evident that the blood is present in the spill. Okay, so could you catch bloodborne pathogens at work? And so, if so, how can you do that? Are you at risk if you're administering first aid? If you're cleaning dry blood? By shaking hands? Catching a sneeze from a coworker? Changing a diaper? Or ouch, a needle stick? So first let's talk about how disease is spread. In order to actually catch disease, the right circumstances or conditions have to be present. First, a pathogen has to be present. That means that there has to be a germ that actually carries the disease with it. And so that has to be present. There has to be enough of it, a critical mass, in order to catch it. One example would be HIV. You would have to have enough exposure to actually catch the disease. Maybe one viron may not give it to you. However, in the same drop of blood, if there's hepatitis B, hepatitis B is much more prevalent and numerous in the blood, and so you would have more exposure there versus HIV. So actually, that means it's easier to catch HIV. I'm sorry, it's easier to catch hepatitis B versus HIV in the same aliquotic blood. Okay, so the host or person must be susceptible to the pathogen. This means that if you've not had your hepatitis B vaccination, then you may be at risk for catching hepatitis. If you have had it, you might have the same exposure as someone else, but you may not and probably will not catch hepatitis B. And the pathogen has to access the correct portal of entry. So if a bloodborne pathogen by virtue of that definition means that it is a blood-borne pathogen, and so you have to get it via the blood or bodily fluids. So if someone sneezes on you, then you're not going to catch HIV or hepatitis B. You might catch a cold if someone sneezes on you, but you won't catch a blood-borne pathogen. So a few definitions. A pathogen, which is a word that I've used several times already, is anything that causes disease. For example, there are viruses such as the ones that cause a common cold, viruses that can cause warts. Bacteria is responsible for strep throat, and as school teachers, I know that you have been faced with students that have had strep throat or skin infections such as endocytosis. Definitions, pathogen, comes with these other examples are fungus. As school teachers, you've probably seen children with tinea capitis or ringworm, and that's caused by a fungus, and that's caused by direct contact, and oral thrush, and that would also be caused by direct contact. Oh, and then we have little flies coming. Okay, what are the modes of transmission? Okay, airborne, meaning the germs are in the air, such as tuberculosis, that's an airborne disease. Common cold is also an airborne disease. Droplets, you see there's a young lady sneezing and she didn't have that tissue with her, you may be at risk for catching whatever it is that she's putting out in that sneeze. Direct contact. So if you're changing a diaper, then you may have access or you may be exposed to something like hepatitis A, which is a spread fecal oral contamination, meaning that you change a diaper, you get some stool that's infected with hepatitis A. You go have lunch without washing your hands, and you will expose yourself. And so that is direct contact as well as fecal oral contact. Fomites. Fomites means that there is a common vehicle. Let's take that cell phone, per se, and the cell phone would be a fomite, meaning that if I use it and I happen to have a cold or virus or something that is transmissible via a fomite, and I give it to someone else to use because, you know, they let me use their phone, they may come back, they may get something more than they bargained for via the cell phone as a fomite. And then there are bloodborne, which is what we're going to concentrate on today. And those diseases I carry through the blood, and one will get those by exposure to blood or secretions. And then vector-borne, and you see our little mosquito there, carries diseases such as malaria, and other types of diseases are vector-borne. So those are the basic ways in which one can catch a disease. So remember that you have to be susceptible, it has to be right modality, and there has to be enough of it for you to actually catch a disease. So let's take a look on. So now, diseases that may be of concern to us, this is herpes, and this is spread by direct contact. And also, it could be spread by bodily fluids as well, but generally it is direct contact, infected material, a broken skin, or broken mucous membranes. Meningitis is something else that would be of concern for us. It's a severe infection covering the brain and the spinal cord, and it can be caused by a virus or bacteria. So symptoms of this could be respiratory illness, sore throat, nausea, vomiting, fever, or headache. It can be transmitted airborne, direct contact, indirect contact, and it may be spread by close contact, sharing eating and drinking utensils. You may have heard many times for college kids, perhaps there's been the spread of meningitis, and the concern about that is actually eating and drinking after each other. So one has to be very careful about actually sharing eating and drinking utensils. Bloodborne pathogens, hepatitis B, C, and HIV are blood-borne pathogens. We mentioned hepatitis A earlier, and that is via fecal oral contamination. But hepatitis B, C, and HIV are blood-borne pathogens. So, and other potentially infectious materials are any bodily fluid that is visibly contaminated with blood, semen, vaginal secretions, cerebral spinal fluid, synovial fluid, that's in the joints, pleural fluid, which is in the lungs, pericardial fluid, around the heart, peritoneal fluid is in the abdomen, and amniotic fluid would be in the lung. Saliva and dental procedures as well. Okay, so at this point, we will move and take a look at our DVD, which gives us a little bit more background on blood-borne pathogens. Finally, we have the video going. So we just wanted... Okay, so this is a video geared toward teachers, and it talks about situations in which you may find yourself. So I'd just like for you to take a look, and our questions were based on this video as well. So just take a look, and just to give you a little bit more guidance about how to handle those possible exposure situations.
Unfortunately, the best intentions are not always what is required. During the course of this video, we're going to demonstrate for school teachers procedures that will help protect them from contact with blood or other types of bodily secretions. Our goal is simple, but profoundly important to teachers. We want to show teachers how to protect themselves from contact with deadly viruses such as HIV and hepatitis B. Before learning how to protect yourself from a blood-borne pathogen, let's spend a few moments examining what they are and the danger they represent. A blood-borne pathogen is a virus that can be found in any type of bodily secretion. This includes blood, urine, or vomit. It's important to realize that blood is not the only secretion that contains a blood-borne pathogen. That's why it's important to always protect yourself when cleaning up any type of spill from bodily fluids. The most common type of pathogens you can become exposed to are the HIV virus, or AIDS, and the hepatitis virus. These viruses can be absorbed into your bloodstream if your skin comes into contact with a bodily fluid that contains one of these viruses. Open cuts or abrasions on your hands can allow a bodily fluid to enter your body. That's why it's critically important to protect yourself when cleaning up a spill. When cleaning up a spill, gloves form the best type of protection. In this next section, watch as a well-trained school teacher demonstrates how to properly put on, take off, and dispose of gloves. First of all, make sure you have gloves available in your classroom, and make sure to wear the gloves prescribed by your school district. Latex gloves are the most common gloves used by school districts. However, if you have a latex allergy, let your supervisor know. They will supply you with a hypoallergenic glove. The fit of the glove is important. Gloves come in several sizes, so make sure you get the proper fit. Also, make sure to remove rings when putting on these tight-fitting gloves. A sharp surface on a ring can easily punch a hole in a glove. Now, watch very closely during the rest of this sequence, because we're going to show you how to properly put on and take off gloves.
As you prepare to put the gloves on, just observe to see if there are any tears or rips in the gloves.
Next, carefully slide gloves onto your hands. Make sure the gloves fit comfortably and form a protective seal. Remember, this is your primary protective barrier against blood-borne pathogens.
Proper way to remove them, you want to take your hands, since this is potentially infected material is on there, you want to grab the outside of the glove and just kind of pull it off without touching the inside or without touching your hand. you kind of wrap it up inside your fist here. And then with your clean hand, you do not want to touch the outside of the glove. You want to reach underneath and just slide that over. And then dispose of it.
As this demonstration points out, you must be careful not to touch the infected gloves with your bare hands. Practice this procedure whenever possible. Once the gloves have been removed, dispose of them by following the procedures of your individual school district. Each time you are exposed to a blood-borne pathogen, you should use the universal precaution of hand washing. Let's watch this demonstration to see the proper hand washing techniques. Whenever you hand wash after cleaning up a spill, use paper toweling as a protective barrier between your hands and the bathroom fixtures. Make sure to thoroughly wash your hands. The soap you use should be an antimicrobial soap. This soap will kill most germs that you are likely to come into contact with. Also, make sure to wash above your wrists. Take your time and do a thorough job. The next step is to take the paper toweling and thoroughly dry your hands. Then, using the paper toweling, turn off the faucets. The final step is to dispose of the paper toweling. Follow your school district's rules for proper disposal. Now that we have demonstrated some of the basic rules about how to protect yourself from blood-borne pathogens, let's turn our attention to how these techniques are implemented during the school day. We're going to demonstrate four separate examples. Each example will serve as a model for a proper response to a potential incident with a blood-borne pathogen.
Are you okay? Missing? She has a nosebleed again.
Nosebleeds are a good example of everyday events that can occur in any classroom. Teachers or office personnel need to clean up these spills immediately. Here are the steps that need to be taken. Once the student has been sent to the office, go to the supply cabinet and get gloves, paper towels, and disinfectant. Next, take the gloves out and put them on. Make sure to take the proper precautions when putting on the gloves. Now, take the paper toweling and blot up the blood on the table. Make sure to thoroughly blot up all of the blood on the table. Now, take the disinfectant and spray the table where the blood spill occurred. Wait a couple of minutes for the disinfectant to kill any potential virus. Then, take the paper toweling and thoroughly wipe down the table. The final step is the disposal of the paper toweling and the careful removal and disposal of the used gloves. And remember to use the universal precaution of thorough hand washing. Remember, this is only one standard procedure for cleaning up the spill. Your school district may have a different procedure. Make sure to follow the procedures mandated by your school district. This is the type of occurrence that happens frequently on school playgrounds. A boy catches an elbow during a basketball game and begins to bleed. A teacher's aide, who is supervising part of a playground, reacts immediately by going to the assistance of the student. Fortunately, a teacher who is also on the playground notices that the aide is going to apply a Kleenex to the open cut before putting on gloves. The teacher immediately intercedes.
Let me help you. Oh, hi, Cheryl.
Hi.
We always want to make sure we put gloves on before we touch gloves.
Notice that the teacher removes from her fanny pack a sealed pair of gloves. She quickly puts on the gloves, explaining to the aide the importance of protecting yourself against contamination. This is an important point to remember. Don't overreact to a student who has a cut and is bleeding. The student can wait for help. What you don't want to do is expose yourself to a bloodborne pathogen. If you don't have gloves, get some help from someone else on the playground, or send a student to the office for a first aid kit. Remember, protect yourself. So far, we have covered spills that only include cleaning up blood. Keep in mind this very important point. Not all viruses are found in blood. Urine, for example, may contain an HIV virus or hepatitis. So let's take a look at what happens when this type of spill occurs. This spill should be treated the same as a spill that contains blood. Follow the same procedures. Put on gloves to protect yourself against contamination. Carefully blot up the urine. Use a disinfectant to spray the infected area. Then wipe down the area with paper toweling. Dispose of the contaminated material. Then go to the bathroom or the nearest sink and thoroughly wash your hands. Always repeat the same procedures when cleaning up a spill, and you will be protecting yourself against an accidental exposure. In this next sequence, we will cover a situation where the best plan of action is to ask for help. Custodians have more expertise when dealing with larger spills. They also are better equipped. In this situation, the custodian wears additional personal protective equipment to protect himself against contamination. Notice that the custodian uses an isolizer to coagulate the material. This makes it easier to clean up. After spraying the area with disinfectant, the custodian takes the mop and thoroughly swabs down the area. Whenever you encounter any type of spill that is large or presents the teacher or office worker with a significant chance of contact, do not clean up the spill yourself. Call the office or contact the custodial department and let them professionally clean up the spill. No one needs to tell public school teachers the importance of protecting their health. The children that attend public schools often carry colds, viruses, and other health risks. Teachers must attend to the needs of these children while making sure to take the proper precautions to ensure that they don't become infected. Keep in mind that taking that extra moment may be the precaution that is needed to prevent you from contacting everything from the flu to the HIV virus. Please stay safe. Your students and your family need you.
Other potentially infectious materials, any body fluid that is visibly contaminated with blood, semen, vaginal secretions, cerebral, spinal fluid, synovial fluid, pleural fluid, pericardial, peritoneal, and amniotic fluid, saliva, also in dental procedures. Okay. Exposure control plan. So the exposure control plan is a requirement of the federal government, and it's a plan to protect employees from exposing themselves to blood-borne pathogens. And if that happens, then there should be a plan in place to take care of it in a timely manner. Part of the blood-borne pathogen regulation is determine the exposure of risk, and we'll talk about that a bit today. Implementation of an infection control program, we'll talk about that. Provide personal protective equipment as needed. Provide hepatitis B vaccination for those of you who are not already vaccinated. Provide extensive training to the personnel. So it's a written plan, and each of the site directors or site managers should have a copy of the exposure control plan. If not, then you should see your manager, and they will make sure that you get a copy of it. And the exposure incident. An exposure incident is that particular thing that happened that occurred, such as a child fell down and bled, or someone came in with a bloody nose and you provided first aid, or someone broke glass and cut themselves, and you picked up the glass as well and cut yourself. So those would be particular exposure incidents. And take a look at the type of work you do and determine from the type of work you do, are you at risk for getting this type of a problem? Occupational exposure, reasonably anticipated skin, eye, mucous membrane, or parenteral contact with blood or other potentially infectious materials that may result from doing one's job. Oh, okay. So, occupational exposure, yes. Surprise. Contaminated sharps. So, most of you won't have access to contaminated sharps, but there may be some students who have diabetes or require other types of injections as well. And then sometimes you might have an EpiPen on hand as well. So those kinds of things you have to be concerned about. So any contaminated object that can penetrate the skin, including, but not limited to, needles, scalpels, broken glass, broken capillary tubes, and exposed ends of dental wires. Contaminated laundry. So, you know, if someone spoils their clothes, then there may be the possibility of contaminated laundry on site as well. So regulated waste is considered to be any waste that is exposed to blood or bodily secretions in a significant amount. If there's just a simple dot of blood on a tissue, that's not really considered regulated waste. But if it's a large amount and you have to really blot it up, then that is considered to be regulated waste and should be exposed of in a particular fashion, not just put in the regular garbage can. Okay, so universal precautions are such that regardless of the type of the person or the relationship that you have with the person, that if there's the possibility of exposure to any secretions or possible blood, then you're going to act in a certain way and make sure that you protect yourself. So any infection control approach whereby all human blood and certain bodily fluids are treated as if they were known to be infectious for HIV, hepatitis B, hepatitis C, or other blood-borne pathogens. So to protect you, your employer is required to supply you with protective equipment. And so depending on what your job is, of course, that determines what the protective equipment is. There are work practice controls, such that there are guidelines written for how you do things that will reduce your exposure, such as there's instructions on washing hands, when you should wash your hands, instructions on the appropriate place to change diapers, and the appropriate way to get a broken glass and those kinds of things to protect you. So that's why there are written guidelines for that.
Dr. Smith, you have a question.
Yes.
If the contaminated items are placed in a sealed bag, can the sealed bag be put in the regular garbage?
No. The sealed bag should not be put in the regular garbage because still at some point there may be some exposure to someone who is unaware that there's a possibility of contaminated fluids. So if you have a significant amount of contaminated material, it should be put in generally a biohazard bag that is red and should be disposed of in the appropriate way via biohazard companies. So what is your risk of exposure? So we take a look at a person's job and determine what their level of exposure is. So high exposure careers or vocations are physicians, nurses, lab technicians, those people who are generally exposed to blood on a regular basis. Medium exposure Regular duties do not include occupational exposure occasionally called upon to perform tasks or procedures which involve exposure, such as childcare workers, teachers, and housekeeping. So in the course of your day, someone may have a nosebleed, or in the course of your day, you may need to change diapers. So that gives you a medium amount of exposure. And low exposure are those people who generally are not going to be in contact with other people, and at least not in contact with their bodily fluids. And those would be practice administrators, fielders, receptionists. Their job does not entail any actual touching of other human beings. Exposure determination. So high and medium exposure positions or jobs must receive full OSHA training and are offered the hepatitis B vaccination free of charge. Those that are at low risk receive the basic education and may or may not be offered the hepatitis B vaccination. It's not required. Universal precautions we talked about already, making sure that you are covered using gloves or eye guards or gowns depending upon what the exposure is. Engineering and work practice controls, again, hand washing. Hand washing is very important. And these are in general guidelines when one should wash their hands. So upon arriving to work, before and after eating, before preparing or serving food, before preparing or giving medication, after using the toilet, before and after diaper change, after having items or children soiled with bodily waste. More engineering and work practice controls. Hand washing should also take place after sneezing or coughing, after playing or caring for pets, after playing outside, before and after using water tables or moist items such as clay, before and after wearing protective gloves, even whenever hands look, feel, or smell unclean, and when leaving work. Engineering practice controls, again, hand hygiene. So if you're not able to wash your hands immediately, it is appropriate to use alcohol-based hand hygiene products. They do significantly reduce the amount of bacteria on the skin. They should be used before and after any of the above listed contacts. And as soon as possible, hands should actually be washed with soap and water, because the mechanical process of actually rubbing your hands together makes it more effective than simply using the hand hygiene liquid. Disposable sharps, again, I think most of you won't have access to disposable sharps, but maybe there may be some children with diabetes and are required to have punctured during the course of the school day. So if that's the case, then you should make sure that you have the appropriate red box to dispose those needles in, and then needles should not be recapped ever. So once you've stuck someone with the needle, then you put it immediately into the box. Most syringes and needles now have protective sheets such that you aren't able to stick yourself, but sometimes people still manage to stick themselves. So general policies. So eating and drinking, these are pretty much common sense things, but still needs to be said that in areas where there may be exposure, so in the diaper changing area, you're not going to eat or drink any liquids or apply lipstick. Personal protective equipment. The office is to maintain an inventory of personal protective equipment, including protection for the eyes, hands, face, head, extremities, air passages, and clothing. Equipment must be used properly and kept in good condition. So you should check with your site managers to make sure you know where the appropriate equipment is. Latex gloves should be used for any skin blood-borne pathogen exposure. For non-impact skin. So if you have a rash, sometimes people may have eczema or they may have cut their hand. So you should make sure that you put on gloves to protect yourself as well if you're touching anyone's skin. Yeah. I wear goggles, face shields, and protective glasses are also used. So if you're having to do any cleanup that, so if you're having to move, if you're having to do any cleanup that is large enough for it to be a splash, then you should also use goggles so that your eyes will be protected. And if there is enough of blood, you should also use a gown. Mask, face protection for any particular splash and gowns we talked about. Okay, so this is kind of an overview of what you should use, and I think in the course of your work, then you may have to control splurting blood, and so you would use disposable gloves, gowns, masks, and protective eyewear. If there's minimal bleeding, then you just need to use gloves. If there's emergency childbirth at your place, hopefully not, then you would use disposable gloves and gowns. And you also may have the position of having to clean nasal secretions and airways. So then you also use gloves there. Handling and cleaning contaminated equipment, you would use gloves. And then the others would be, again, if the secretion is likely to splash, then you would also use a gown. You should also have a listing of material data sheets in your site, and this is a listing of any hazardous materials such as cleaning supplies that are around, so your cleaning crew would have that. And what this is information that tells you what to do in case there's a spill or there's a hazard or if it gets splashed into one's eye and that sort of thing. So actually, if a child gets into any type of potentially hazardous material, then you would apply first aid immediately. You would call the poison control center if there's any ingestion. Okay, so where is it? Where is your spill kit? There should be something close by because you may not always be able to call housekeeping. So there should be some cat litter. There should be a broom and a dustpan so that you can pick up any small cleaning. If it's a large cleaning job, then certainly housekeeping should be called. There should be an eyewash station. You should designate a place that you can use to rinse out eyes. If there's a splash or bleach or paint or anything like that, then you should be able to access an eyewash station. Okay, the epidemiology and transmission of hepatitis and HIV. So we'll talk a little bit about how one gets hepatitis and how one gets and protects themselves from getting hepatitis and HIV.
A quick question, Dr. Smith.
Yes.
Just to confirm, if the contaminated gauzes, et cetera, are placed in a red biohazard bag, then they can be placed in a regular garbage can?
No, they cannot be placed in a regular garbage can. They actually have to be disposed of by a company that disposes biohazard waste. So again, we're talking about the amount of blood. So if someone has a small nosebleed, then that's not likely to be something that you have to have a big biohazard plan for. But if it's a large amount of blood, then it should be actually disposed of via one of the biohazard companies.
You have a follow-up. So we have to hire a company to do that. Can you recommend the company?
I would leave that to the administrators, because I don't know, but there's several companies out there, so I don't want to favor one company or another. But there should be a plan such that you may not have a regular contract, but you should have a plan to be able to call one of the companies.
Another comment was for a nosebleed.
Not for a nosebleed, unless it's a massive nosebleed. Again, if it's something that you use a tissue or gauze to apply pressure, then that's different. That's a small amount of blood. But if you had to use this copious amounts of blood, then you have to dispose of it via a biohazard company. But no, not for that simple nosebleed.
Okay, that's another question.
Okay. Hepatitis. Hepatitis caused by hepatitis B or C virus. Is an inflammation of the liver that may lead to liver failure and cancer. Symptoms include mild to none flu-like symptoms. They may have a mild fever, extreme fatigue, joint and muscle aches, nausea, vomiting, extreme fatigue, diarrhea, and jaundice. Transmission, parental or via neonic, is the most common way in which one would be exposed to hepatitis. Mucous membrane contamination, eyes, mouth, is another way. Remember, as I mentioned earlier, hepatitis is much more, there's many more virons of hepatitis in blood, concentrated in blood versus HIV. So it is more contagious. Sexual activity, prenatal care, a mother can pass it on to her child via the placenta, and then mother can also pass it on to the child via breast milk. The hepatitis virus is pretty strong, and it can last probably up to 2 months outside of the body. So if there is dried blood on a counter and it has been exposed to hepatitis, then in fact one can catch it from exposure to the dried blood.
Next one.
So 804,000 to 1.1 million people are estimated to be infected with hepatitis in the United States today. So can you contract HIV or HIV or hepatitis B from drinking from a fountain, from the toilet seat, from the doorknobs, insect bites, shaking hands, sharing telephones, eating meals together, sneezing or coughing? And so the answer is no. There's oftentimes concerns about maybe catching HIV or hepatitis from someone. But via these common avenues, this is not possible that you're going to catch HIV or hepatitis B. So there is no need to ostracize or try to separate yourself from someone from these type of situations. So the chance of contraction is approximately 1 million, there are approximately 1 million persons affected. Healthcare workers who are exposed to to hepatitis B, if not immunized, maybe about 30% of them may come down with hepatitis B. The chance of developing chronic disease is about 8%. So not everybody who is exposed to hepatitis and actually gets hepatitis develops chronic disease, but it's a pretty bad disease if you get it. The younger you are, the more higher risk is of developing chronic active hepatitis. So hepatitis C is there's a smaller risk. But it's actually more virulent. Many more of the people who have hepatitis C will develop more liver damage. HIV caused by the human immunodeficiency virus attacks the immune system and causes the development of AIDS. So as you may know, having HIV and having AIDS are not necessarily synonymous. HIV means that you've been exposed to the virus and in fact you are positive, but you may not have symptoms. Having AIDS actually means that you have symptoms and your immune system has been affected by the HIV virus. There is a long incubation period. It can be from 2 to 10 years. more than 1.1 million people in the United States are living with HIV. So 1,144,500 persons, 13 years and older, are living with HIV according to the CDC from the 2013 publication. 180,900 or 15% of these people are not aware that they have HIV. There are 50,000 new cases of HIV discovered annually. So this graph shows the blue at the bottom shows the incidence or the number of new cases of HIV that have been discovered since 1980 on to 2010. So you see that there was a rise in 1983, 84, and then as we begin to learn more about HIV, then there are fewer cases, newly discovered cases, because of course we learned that one can protect themselves by using protective equipment as well. But now the red line shows the number of people who are actually living with AIDS. And I think that that is a testament to the science and the learning and the using of antiretroviral medications for keeping persons who are affected with AIDS, affected with HIV, alive. And so you see that that number is increasing and increasing. And I put this in to, again, reinforce the fact that many people may have HIV and have no symptoms. And so there is no way for you to know which person you should use protective equipment if you're applying first aid and which persons you should not. Transmission are via blood products, semen, vaginal secretions have been directly linked to HIV. The chance of contraction in general public is about 1 in 10 million. Of course, depending upon your lifestyle and your risk factors. Symptoms. 50% or more of HIV-infected persons within a couple of weeks may come down with what looks like a respiratory virus or develop a rash, swollen lymph nodes, headache. Some persons may be asymptomatic for some years before it actually develops into symptoms. Okay, exposure incidents. If there is an exposure incident in your place, these are the steps that you should follow. These things should be also listed in your exposure control plan. So immediately you should apply first aid. So if you cut yourself or stick yourself with a needle or something, then you should clean it and make sure that you apply an antibiotic ointment or whatever you have close. To decrease the possibility that you would catch something from that. Then you are to notify your supervisor. Then you may refer for medical care, and based on the exposure and if your exposure is, there's a likely risk of being exposed to a blood-borne pathogen, then your blood may be tested at that time to see if you have already been previously exposed, and then later 2 to 6 weeks or so to see if there's any change in the titers. Medical personnel will determine the need for any prophylaxis. If there's exposure to hepatitis B, then you can receive immunoglobulin as well as the hepatitis B vaccine if you've not already received it. Exposure to HIV, the prophylactic medication is generally going to be AZT. There should also be paperwork, an incident report. Those things need to be filled out as well after the first aid has taken place. Your employer is required to provide you with a hepatitis B vaccination free of charge. So healthcare organizations and other agencies with employees with potential occupational risk of contracting blood-borne pathogens required to offer hepatitis B vaccine, free charge.
We do have a question.
Actually. Okay, I'm sorry.
Okay, so if I go to someone's home and they have HPV and there is some dried blood and I touch it, do I get HPV?
Well, if you go back to the beginning slides when we talked about the conditions that are necessary, one meaning that you've not had HPV vaccinations before. Number two, there is enough of the germ in the blood such that you would catch the disease from it. So if those things are present, then you may catch it. So yes, dry blood, you may be at risk. So again, use universal precautions if you're going to be in contact with anyone's secretions that you know has HPV, that virus.
Okay, that's the only question we have for now.
Great. So the vaccination, go to the next one, consists of three. There is one at zero time. The second one is 1 to 2 months later. The third one is going to be about 4 months after the second one. So in the course of about 6 months, we should receive all three of the vaccinations. It is about 80-90% effective. Sometimes one will check titers to make sure that they have responded appropriately. Now, this is offered to all employees, and you, for whatever reason, may decide to decline getting the vaccination. And if you are to do that, then you have to complete a declination form, and that would also be found in your exposure control plan. So you may decline if you've already received the vaccination and you know that you're not susceptible. You may decline because you're afraid of needles, and I hope that would not be the case, because you can prevent a very serious illness by actually just going on and getting the vaccination. All right, so here we are. You want to try, what time is it? I think we're going to try one more time to see the video.
Can we do that?
Because the answers for our questions are actually found in the video, not that one. The video number two.
Video number two. Okay.
We're going to try video number two. We're going to try to watch our video. We won't try multiple times, but maybe it'll work for us this time. In the meantime, I can answer any questions that may have come up.
We do have one question here that I was hoping Paulette would answer too. Essentially, it says at a training previously, she remembers specifically them saying that during the training that to use the red biohazard bag for bleeds, etc. But we can dispose it in regular trash cans. We don't need to, since they don't deal with syringes, etc. Only with gauzes, so long as they are placed in a red biohazard bag, we should be fine placing it in a regular trash can.
Well, I don't know who gave that instruction. So.
Yeah, I was hoping Paulette would come on.
Right. I guess you'll have to speak with your supervisors regarding that. Tuberculosis has been decreasing since 1992. The rate of decrease is less in foreign-born persons. The rate of tuberculosis cases in persons born outside of the United States. Okay.
Is that the right slide?
Mm-hmm. That's the right slide. The rate of decrease is less in foreign-born persons. And the rate of tuberculosis cases in persons born outside of the United States continues to rise. It has increased from 29% in 1993 to 63%. And 2012, according to the CDC. The case rate among foreign-born persons, 15.9% per 100,000, was approximately 11 times that higher than in U.S.-born persons. So if you are familiar with the screening tool that's used, many of the questions are based on if the person was born in the United States or not. It seems to be that there is a higher risk of tuberculosis in persons born in other third world countries or lesser developed countries and bringing it into the United States. Tuberculosis, and what does that mean if you have tuberculosis? So if you have the test, the positive PPD, someone puts a little needle prick under your skin, you get a little, what looks like a mosquito bite, and it swells a little bit, and then you come back in 2 days to have it red. So what does that mean if you come back in 2 days and it's read as positive? Generally, when they read it, they're going to be looking at the amount of swelling that's around it, not the amount of redness. So don't be concerned if there is redness and no swelling, but the concern will be the swelling. So a positive PPD does not mean necessarily that you have a disease or the disease of tuberculosis. It means that you've been exposed to tuberculosis. And that's what we call latent tuberculosis, LTD. And it's not considered to be contagious. What it means is that you have been exposed to the germ. The germ is in your body, but it's most likely dormant and not causing any problems. The infection is generally limited by your immune system. And this is what causes the positive PPD of the skin test. So 10% of the people who have been affected with the TB germ may actually develop the disease within about 2 years or so. So I bring this to concern because if you have someone that has a positive PPD but no evidence of actually having tuberculosis, then you're not at risk of catching the TB from that person or that child. And children are very unlikely to spread the disease because they don't have the ability to cough. When I say children, I mean someone who is, say, less than two, because they really don't have the ability to cough in such a manner that you're going to
spread it.
Less than five.
Children each.
Yeah, right. Well, now I'm going to say children less than two. Okay, because they don't have the ability to really cough it up. Okay, so however, again, going back to that, again, latent TB, remember, is not active disease. So if one has latent TB, that means that they don't have the disease, so you don't have to be concerned if someone has positive TB in your class. That's my point. Okay, active TB, the immune system is unable to limit the infection, and it is highly contagious. Generally, that's going to be adults. It's not going to be children. Symptoms will be a persisting cough that lasts at least 3 weeks, weight loss, fever, night sweats, and decreased appetite. Tuberculosis testing, the PPD, this is generally what's used. Now also people are using blood tests. You might have heard of the term quantiferon gold. I should have put that on the slide as well. That's another way of testing. For people who perhaps maybe have had a BCG vaccination in the past, and that's a vaccination against tuberculosis. And so because in vaccinations they actually give you a little bit of the germ, then you may respond to it. So quantiferon gold is a test that can differentiate between a positive PPD because of the BCG in the past and actual disease. So the PPD must be read by a health professional within 48 to 72 hours after the administration. So if you, you know, skip a day or you decide to go back a week later or so, then you know that reading would be invalid. Okay. So we talked a bit about the pediatric and adolescent risk assessment questionnaire, and it's used to screen children who are not to screen to determine the child's possible risk. And also that must be reviewed annually by a healthcare provider. If there are no known risks, generally you won't apply a PPD. And the assessment must be done annually. And I think, all right, and then there is treatment. For latent TB, even though there's no disease, we prophylactically treat persons with medication so they don't develop the disease itself. So if they could be, they can still have a positive PPD and on medication, but it does not mean that they have tuberculosis. Okay. Okay, prevention for positive PPDs with no active disease under certain circumstances. Recent conversion, close contact with TB patients, immunodeficient, IV drug users and under 35 years of age, and they would receive the prophylactic medication that was shown on the previous slide. Medications generally going to be taken for 6 to 12 months. It's shown to be 70% effective in reducing the risk of actual development of active tuberculosis. And if you want more information, then those are the sources that you can use.